Welcome back to another episode of 40 Facts About the 40K Universe. I am your host, Gershwan, and you were watching One Mind Syndicate. Today we continue talking about the Black Templars as we get into the much-requested Grimaldus video. If you're new to the channel, subscribe. We push Warhammer 40K lore videos every single day. And if you have any suggestions, comment down below. Now stay to the end of the video because we have a special giveaway for you guys. And thank our patrons on Patreon for the giveaways and for us creating these videos. If you guys want to support us, link in the description. But with that said, let's get into 40 facts on High Chaplain Merrick Grimaldus. Merrick Grimaldus is the High Chaplain of the Black Templar Space Marine Chapter, and a veteran of a score of successful Black Templar Crusades. His rise through the ranks of the Chapter was meteoric, for he once stood as the youngest Sword Brethren in the Chapter's history. He soon rose from his Martial Sword Brethren and was inducted into the Mysteries of the Reclusium after the Battle of Fire and Blood. The Chaplains were impressed by the faith and devotion to the Emperor displayed by the young Grimaldus, for he had the makings of a powerful warrior priest. The young chaplain took his vows before the Shattered Sword of Dorne, aboard the Black Templar's flagship, the Eternal Crusader. He learned under the veteran and stern High Chaplain, Mordred, and soon justified the chaplain's faith in him by zealously leading the warriors of the Black Templars into battle. Many times he suffered grievous wounds in the thickest of fighting, but always steadfastly refused to succumb. Unlike many of his brother chaplains, Grimaldus preferred to inspire his men through his deeds rather than through rhetoric. On those rare occasions when Grimaldus did speak, his voice commanded the attention of all around, the rarity of his speech ensuring not a single word went unheard. Grimaldus' words cut straight through his brother's warrior spirit, and it was no surprise that upon Mordred's death, the High Chaplain named Grimaldus his successor with his final breath. It wouldn't be long before this newly crowned High Chaplain would be tested on the field of battle. When the Shadow Wolf Space Marine Chapter's homeworld of Varan was ravaged by the foul Xenos of a Tyranid Splinter Fleet, the Shadow Wolf's Chapter attempted to defend their homeworld from the predations of this merciless Great Devourer. Astropathic distress beacons were transmitted through the warp weeks before the attack, before their fortress monastery finally fell to the enemy. Chaplain Grimaldus and the Black Templars swiftly answered their brother chapter summon and attempted to penetrate the swarms of Tyranids besieging the ruins of the Shadow Wolf's Fortress Monastery. But the unrelenting ferociousness of the alien tide hampered their efforts. Grimaldus and the Black Templars arrived at the bitter end, standing witness to the actions of a handful of Shadow Wolves that remained, their blades broken and their bolters spent. They died in an honorable battle as they made their defiant last stand, still chanting the litanies of hate against the alien, chanting their bitter fury at their foes, even as they were annihilated. The lone Shadow Wolf's battle brother, though horrendously wounded and on his knees beneath the chapter standard, attempted to maintain his chapter's honor to the last, for the Shadow Wolf's war banner could not be allowed to fall while one of the Astartes of the chapter yet lived. The doomed space marine held it aloof defiantly, keeping the banner upright and proud even as the Xenos creatures tore him apart. He died in what Grimaldus could only describe as a beautiful death. The Shadow Wolf's heroic and valiant actions played a pivotal part in the growth of High Chaplain Grimaldus and fueled the new High Chaplain's zealot belief not only in the will of the Emperor but the hatred of the Xenos. After a century of faithful service, Grimaldus was elevated to the esteemed role of Reclusiarch of the Chapter and accompanied High Marshal Helbrick to the war-torn world of Armageddon to stop a massive invasion of the strategic Hive World by the Orc Warlord, Godskull Magorak Thraka. Three crusades were dispatched to Armageddon and under the direction of High Marshal deployed in an area where the fighting was thickest. Grimaldus was charged by his chapter master to lead one of these crusades into Hive Hell's Reach. Grimaldus' forces were supported by the 101st Armageddon Steel Legion Imperial Guard Regiment and the Titans of the Legio Invigilata. Before the battle started, the Purest Intent, a derelict Space Marine strike cruiser from the now extinct Space Wolves chapter that had been recovered by the Orcs, was badly damaged by Armageddon's orbital defenses after it drifted dangerously close to the planet and crash-landed just outside the Hive City of Hell's Reach. The Black Templars investigated the wreckage of the once-proud vessel perform the distasteful duty of eradicating any orc survivors. They performed this duty flawlessly, though it left a bad taste in their mouths. Though it inspired confidence and lit the fires of faith in the mortal defenders of Hell's Reach. Their duty done, the Black Templars pulled their forces back into the walls of the Hive City. And soon, Hell's Reach found itself besieged by thousands of orcs who swarmed the Hive from the vast fleet of submersibles launched from the icy Deadlands far to the south. One of the main bastions of resistance was centered upon the Temple of the Emperor's Ascendant, a vast basilica that had stood on Armageddon since the earliest days of human colonization. A great horde of orcs attacked the temple, and for nearly 2 solar months, the defenders held the orcs at bay, before the greenskins finally penetrated the temple precincts, looting and destroying priceless holy relics in equal measure. The Hive's militia and an Imperial Guard unit fled, but the Black Templars would not yield, as Grimaldus bellowed defiantly, "I have dug my grave in this place, and I will either triumph or I will die." Such heroism hardened the hearts of the fleeing defenders, and they turned and fell upon the orcs. The battle degenerated into a bloody melee in the heart of the building that was only ended when the entire structure collapsed in a maelstrom of rubble and fire. All were feared lost, but a day later, the bloody but unbowed form of Chaplain Grimaldus crawled from the ruins, bearing the last imperial relics of the temple, and vowing that all would remember the lives that had been lost in the defense of Armageddon. A retinue of 3 Xenobite servitors, augmetic servants vat-grown by the chapter's apothecaries, emerged alongside Grimaldus, hauling the temple's precious artifacts. These servitors carried the last surviving relics of Hive Hell's Reach Temple of the Emperor's Ascendant, a column from the major altar, the remains of the banner of the Emperor's Victorious, and the blessed water from the stoop of Elucidation. The chapter's apothecaries, who later treated Grimaldus' wounds, claimed that it was a miracle that he was still alive, let alone the strength to climb from the rubble of a destroyed building. Upon the commencement of the planet's season of fire, Grimaldus was gifted the title Hero of Hell's Reach. Weeks after Grimaldus' victory at Hive Hell's Reach, he received word of a discovery of a crashed Stormed Eagle. The downed gunship had fallen victim to the fearful winds and violent storms that racked Armageddon skies, heralding the infamous season of fire. Acquiring a Valkyrie from the 101st Armageddon Steel Legion Regiment, Grimaldus and his subordinate chaplain initiate, Cynaric, departed the safety of the Hive City to investigate the crash site despite the horrendous weather conditions. The air was severe enough to scald unprotected flesh, and while the Astartes power armor offered a shield against the elements, it wouldn't protect them for long. Grimaldus was unable to determine the chapter's origin of the Storm Eagle from its outward appearance, as whatever colors it had borne into battle were long gone, stolen by the storm. Its symbols of allegiance were also eroded by ash and dirt in the turbulent air. Smashing his way through the ship's bulkhead with his Crozius maw, Grimaldus and Cynaric found the body of a lone space marine pilot, clad in the burnished gold, lying in an unaging repose, where the deck met the weapon-racked walls. The Reclusiarch recognized the chapter's colors, the Celestial Lions, but this discovery left more questions than answers. Grimaldus couldn't understand what this gunship was doing all the way out here in this remote location, so far from High Volcanus, nearly half a world away from its point of origin. Removing the dead Space Marine's helmet, the decay indicated that he had been several solar days dead. Upon further inspection, Grimaldus discovered a hololithic imager the size of a human fist, maglocked to the dead warrior's belt. Once freed and activated, it gave rise to a flickering blue image, the ghost of another warrior in another city. Wearing the heraldry of the Celestial Lions and carrying a skull-faced helm beneath one arm, Grimaldus recognized his fellow chaplain as Death Speaker Jul Kara, whose wavering voice brought grim tidings. "Grimaldus, they lied to us about Mannheim Gap. They sent us here to die." The Mannheim Gap was a canyon running through the mountains north of High Volcanus. It was a rent in Armageddon's priceless earth, tore open by the slow, active dance of the world's tectonics. Any who dwelled there for more than a handful of weeks knew that Armageddon was not a world that slept easy, whether due to greenskins, dust storms, or yet another war. The Celestial Lions chapters were told that the canyon had to be assaulted, for there lay a nest of mechanical heresies, where the green-skinned aliens were forge-breeding their scrap iron god machines, known as Gargants. Volcanus' forces had to strike before the alien titans became active, or the tide would forever turn against the city's defenders. The Imperial Guard could not be trusted to deal with such a surgical strike, nor could the city organize a mass withdrawal and redeployment of its deadly entrenched Imperial Guard elements to make it a plausible option. It had to be the Lions. Primitive void shielding protected the site from orbital bombardment. The Lions had to strike over land without drop pods, marching into the ravine alongside their tanks, attacking in battalion regiment like some echo of the Horus Heresy and the millennia of crude warfare before it. The Lions sent in reconnaissance, of course. They scouted and watched, deeming Imperial intelligence reliable. None of the alien godwalkers were infused with life yet, but time was not on their side. Every solar hour they spent behind their fortress walls was another hour that brought the Gargant machines closer to awakening. And finally, 500 Lions attacked. The last half of the chapter went to war, knowing that the enemy's numbers were beyond the capabilities of the Guard to confront. They chose to bring overwhelming force to strike fast and hard, countering their crippling inability to strike from the skies. Even though human resistance and greenskin forces were impossible to compare, 500 Adeptus Astarte warriors is an overwhelming weapon in any imaginable reckoning. The Lions' commanders were right to commit their full fury. Any chapter master would have done the same. There was no possible way the enemy could have known such a force was coming to destroy them, and there was simply no way to prepare for 500 Space Marine warriors. Strike with ferociousness and destroy the enemy. Fall back before getting entrenched in a full-scale battle. It should have worked. Unfortunately, the Gargants were not sleeping. They were waiting. If these god machines was all they had to deal with, the Lions might still have fought their way clear without being slaughtered. They might have even won, despite dying to the last man. The Lions' gold battle tanks raged skyward, streaming last cannon fire, bursting thin shields, and scorching holes in the hulls of the towering enemy war machines. Leaders shouted orders, in control of their warriors, even in the heat of battle, establishing where to strike, where to push through the orc lines, where to move in defense of tank battalions threatened by enemy infantry. Even when the Gargants awoke, the last half of the Noble Chapter still fought to win. They would purge the canyon at the cost of their own lives. Rogaldorn himself would have stood with them that day, but the tide truly turned. The enemy ambushed unfolded further. Greenskins spilled from the earth, pouring in hordes from the warrens within the canyon sides and the rocky ground. Thousands of them, roaring beneath fanged war banners and standards made from crucified lions taken in other battles. Their fresh army surged into the ravine, filling it like sand in an hourglass, blocking all hope of withdrawal and eliminating any chance of victory. Somehow, the orcs knew that the Lions were coming. What other reason could there be to bury whole war clans under the rocks, waiting for an assault? Their overlord was a beast clad in scrapwork armor, the biggest greenskin the Lions had ever seen. He ate the dead, his own and the Lions. War leader Vularc buried a warsword, Jahara, in the beast's belly and carved 3 meters of stinking alien guts free. It did nothing. The Lions fought back as they fell, but they knew they had been betrayed. A traitor somewhere had fed word to the enemy, and the orcs made the most of this assault. But soon the extent of the treachery was revealed, as sniper fire, deadly accurate, rained down from the canyon walls. Not the solid shell rattle of greenskin projectile throwers, for the Lions knew how these aliens fought. This was viciously precise laser weaponry, knifing through their officers' helms from above. Death speakers, war leaders, spirit walkers, even pride leaders cut down with fire, too precise, too clinical to be orcs. It took the Celestial Lions 4 solar hours to fight free. They carved their way back the way they came, abandoning a sea of dead tanks, slain battle brothers, and butchered enemy bodies. The gene seed of half of their chapter lay rotting at the bottom of that canyon, unharvested by their apothecaries and defiled by the thousands of foes they left alive. The Lions had fled from the field, and the most valiant battle the Celestial Lions ever fought was in that retreat. Never had they faced such odds. The last of them cut their way free, pulling their brothers from the storm of blades, and fell back to their fortress within the enemy at their heels. the Xenos flooded the forward base before most of their survivors had even arrived. The Alliance had to fight just to escape their own falling fortress. Even then, for every gunship that raced free, another two were shot down in flames. The survivors returned to Volcanis. Only three officers remained. Three officers above the rank of Pride Leader. Deathspeaker Jul'Kara, who appeared on Grimaldus' message. War Leader Vakembi, the last surviving captain. And Lifebinder Kai Took, the Lion's last apothecary. The chapter's future rested in his skills, but the final insult was yet to play out. The last gasp in this drama of shame and treachery occurred later that evening. The Lion's territory inside the city was a cold foundry, nearly lightless, with a perimeter of ferrocrete patrolled by the remaining warriors. Kai Took did not survive that first night. The Lion found him at dawn, slouched against the last land raider, shot through the eyelids. The gene seed he had carried was gone, and he would harvest no more. The depths of the Celestial Lion's plights were dire indeed. They had lost their fleet, their armory, officers, and almost all hope of rebuilding their chapter. They couldn't even cling to pride after the shame of defeat. All that remained to them was the truth. The Lions vowed to survive long enough to speak it. The Imperium needed to know what had happened here. With this knowledge, Grimaldus and Cyneric departed the crash site and made their way back to the protective walls of Hive Hell's Reach. Once safely inside, the Reclusiarch sent a secure Vox message to the Eternal Crusader, the flagship of High Marshal Helbrick. When he contacted the mighty vessel, he relayed his orders to a chapter serf, instructing him to complete four tasks. First, he was to make contact with every vessel of the Celestial Lion still in orbit so that he could have a full accounting of their war fleet. Second, they were to contact whatever command structure remained in place at High Volcanis, and to acquire a detailed report of every Adeptus Astarte casualty in that region since the war's commencement. Third, he and Cyneric needed a gunship to return to the Eternal Crusader. If the coming storm hit before arrangements could be made, they would risk teleportation. For the fourth and final order, the Eternal Crusader was to make contact with a ranking officer of the Celestial Alliance garrisoned at High Volcanis. He warned that the transmission would most assuredly be monitored, no matter what inscription process were run. The following message was to be delivered. Grimaldus knew that he had to be careful how he worded this message. It was only six words. No pity, no remorse, no fear. Back aboard the Eternal Crusader, Reclusiarch Grimaldus met with High Marshal Helbrick, producing for him the handheld hollow recorder which relayed the dire message from the Celestial Lion's death speaker. The High Marshal inquired as to what the Reclusiarch hoped to accomplish. Grimaldus sought to establish contact with the Celestial Lions to take stock of their losses, and if possible, to destroy those who had betrayed them. But the senior knew in his heart that this would be impossible no matter how much it appealed to him. The High Marshal warned Grimaldus that he risked dragging the chapter into direct conflict with the Inquisition. There was no denying it, he did. The High Marshal sympathized with Grimaldus's cause, for injustice was to be stopped and impurity must be purged. But the Eternal Crusader was to set sail in 3 days in order to push the fleeing Thraka, the orc warlord who had led this massive war into the invasion of Armageddon. The Reclusiarch requested to be left behind. The High Marshal was surprised by Grimaldus's request. He was caught between the purity of a war against an external enemy and a just war against an internal foe. He would fight both if he could, but the Orc Warlord's death took priority over all else. The Orc Warlord responsible for Armageddon could not be allowed to flee from his grasp. The retribution called as loud as justice. But Helbrick could not overlook that the Celestial Lion's devastating losses was the principal reason he believed his Reclusiarch's concerns were valid. Justice called to them. And at the very least, the Black Templars wished to learn the truth of the matter. He ordered Grimaldus to go to High Volcanis to learn the truth of what had happened. If the Lions were destined to die, the High Marshal wished to hear the truth of their tale before it was too late. Soon Grimaldus and his charge made their way to Armageddon Prime, where High Volcanis was still being besieged by the enemy. The Celestial Lions firebase was located atop a natural rise in the landscape, supremely defensible, with great battlements and sacred statuaries of fallen heroes staring down at any who would dare bring the fight to these dark walls. The whole site was already in ruin. The pair of Black Templars were honored for their presence by the remaining lions. Grimaldus noticed right away that several of the Celestial Lions were plundering their own firebase of supplies, loading up their surviving Thunderhawks with brutal efficiency, the warriors themselves keeping at least one hand free to reach for a boulder at a second's notice. A lone Space Marine came forward, bearing the black helm of a Pride leader. He knelt before the Reclusiarch and removed his dark helmet. Grimaldus was greeted by the sight of a face that was a warm, rich brown complexion of a human born in equatorial climates. Though he had never been to the lion's homeworld of Elysium IX, he had met many of his dark-skinned sons. A culture of hunters, proud from birth to death, true scions of Dorne. Grimaldus did not recognize the warrior who introduced himself as Pride Leader Ekene Dubaku, a squad sergeant. This did not bode well. He was the senior surviving lion who now led those that remained. The veteran marine explained that there were 96 lions still drawing breath upon this world, and that he had inherited command from war leader Vakembe, he of the spear that hunts hearts. He walked into the Emperor's embrace 18 days earlier. Grimaldus knew Vakembe, a stalwart space marine officer and a deadly swordsman. The Reclusiarch inquired as to the whereabouts of Deathspeaker Jokara. Pride leader told him that he had been slain by the Greenskins nearly 24 days past. Now the surviving lions were looting what was left of their supplies on this forward base. They had little choice since it was overrun. Their fallback stronghold was within Volcanus itself, but they risked raids in this forward area every 3 days. Ammunition was low, production and resupply from their fleet had dropped to almost nothing. Grimaldus wondered why the lions had not requested the aid from other chapters, but understood that Dorne's blood ran thick in the veins of his descendants. It was difficult to lay pride aside, even in the face of devastation, especially then, for this was when a warrior was truly tested. What other time could be finer for proving that a man is strong enough to stand alone? Dubaku explained that he had swallowed his pride long enough to request aid from the Flesh Terrors chapter and the Black Templars. The former was as depleted as they were, and the latter were preparing to take the fight to the stars. The lions felt that they had no right to beg for scraps while being left behind, so they existed by plundering their fallen fortress and looting their own dead. The Reclusiarch was then struck by one thing above all else. The Celestial Lions were effectively dead. While 100 Astartes yet remained, they operated without a single voice from their chapter's high command, and their ranking veteran officer was simply a squad sergeant. Grimaldus ordered the lions to finish loading their gunships. He would then have Dubaku speak to him of everything that had happened to the chapter since they made planetfall. It remained to be seen just what Jokara expected of Grimaldus, or what he could achieve. It already felt less like he was summoned to save the lions, and more like he was called to hold vigil, watching over them as they died. The Pride Leader's tale was a grim one. The Reclusiarch's blood ran cold as Dubaku revealed each betrayal that had occurred. Mere weeks into the war, half the Celestial Lions chapter lay dead, the names of their slain added to each dawn to the roll of honors. The survivors fought on. Grimaldus quickly realized that the surviving lions meant to die on this world. The Pride Leader confirmed this was true. The lions would die alongside their brothers, as it should be. Deathspeaker Jokara wished for Grimaldus to know the truth behind the coming of the Last Stand, and ensure that those that shared their Primarch's blood never spoke ill of this chapter. Cynaric advocated that the lions return to Elysium, to endure the shame if they must, just as the Crimson Fist endured their shame after the Battle of Ryan's World. They had to rebuild their chapter. The galaxy must not lose the Celestial Lions forever. The lions scoffed at this suggestion. Their chapter had been savaged beyond resurrection. Men, material, knowledge, all of it was gone. They had nothing to hand down any generation that would follow them. The lions refused to flee like cowards, but it was not cowardice Cynaric advocated. It was survival. Survival to preserve precious blood and to rise again to fight another day. Grimaldus agreed with both opposing viewpoints, for a glorious last stand was no more or less respectable than preserving the infinite value of a Space Marine chapter. But Grimaldus wondered if Cyneric would advocate shame if he were the one facing the prospect of so glorious of a last stand. Easier to speak of shame than endure it, and yet the chapter had to survive. The Lions revealed to Grimaldus that the Inquisition wanted to silence them. The Reclusiarch assured them that this was not the case. Far from it, they were using the Celestial Lions to make an example. The Lions were the most recent casualty in the Inquisition's campaign to rein in on the autonomy of the Adeptus Astartes. The Inquisition tolerated no attack on its sovereign rights, yet the Lions had challenged them, and now all would bear witness to the price of their chapter's rebellion. The sabotage, the conflicting orders, and the ambushes. A chapter would die in the shame for it. Millions of Imperial citizens would hear of how they were killed on Armageddon. A mere handful would then return with the truth, and each of those would be Adeptus Astartes officers who would tread with much more caution when they dealt with the Inquisition in the future. The lesson would be learned just as Inquisitor Apollyon's cronies wished it. Digesting this information, Pride Leader Dubaco explained to the Reclusiarch that his chapter would make for the Mannaheim Gap. Dubaco explained that though many of the Gargants were gone, it was still a well-defended Orc stronghold. It remained a cancer of enemy presence in the Volcanus territory, and it must fall. This seemed idealistic to Grimaldus at best. He informed them that it would not fall, not to a handful of Lions, no matter how noble and proud. Dubaco countered that they would die trying, for this was where the Lions had chosen to die. It had to be theirs. Their bones would lie alongside their brothers. Grimaldus inquired if the Lions would fight alone, in which Dubaco replied that they would. Volcanus could not spare its Imperial Guard regiments. Even with Mannheim emptied of Gargants in the weeks since the massacre, a fact that they still could not verify, it was still a brutal target, rich with enemy presence. 5 of the Lions' battle companies had failed to take it. A few thousand guardsmen would be nothing more than spitting into the wind. At any rate, the Lions could trust none of them, for the Inquisition's talons were everywhere. They would die as warriors. After hearing the tale, Grimaldus decided that Cyneric had been right. The Lions' death would be a disservice to the Imperium. No matter the greatness of their glorious last stand, no matter the heroism of individual warriors as they spent their life's blood, the Lions argued that this was how they wanted it to end, to finish their legacy in fire, not in centuries of painstaking laboratory work to preserve their bloodline. They wanted to die as warriors. And indeed they would, thought Grimaldus, 100 warriors dying in glory and denying the possibility of thousands of warriors who might be needed in a darker future. It was Rogaldorn's way to fight no matter the odds. Death against overwhelming odds was no shame to any warrior of an Imperial Fist gene seed. Yet those were lessons first taught 10,000 standard years ago, when the Imperium was so much stronger. The last century of the current Dark Millennium had all but bled mankind's empire dry. The Reclusiarch admired Dubaco for his hunger to taste a glorious death, even if it was the last charge few would remember. Grimaldus asked as to when the Lions would make their final stand. Dubaco informed the Reclusiarch that they would not delay the inevitable. His chapter would gather their resources the next day at their forward base and make one last scouting run for supplies and survivors. The Lions would charge to war at dawn the day after. The Pride Leader then made one last request of the stern chaplain. He requested that Grimaldus grant final blessings to the surviving Celestial Lions warriors. The Black Templars had only agreed to speak of the Lions' death, that he understood it. Now, they wished for him to bless their damnation. The Lions had no surviving death speaker. They wished for Grimaldus to bless warriors of another chapter, sharing the Black Templar's sacred rituals and vowing before the Emperor and Rogaldorn that their deaths would be a noble testament to the Imperial Fist bloodline. They wished for the Reclusiarch to endorse their death, for the Celestial Lions believed it was a curse to die unblessed. Grimaldus looked upon the surviving Lions, standing amongst them during their desperate, respectful silence. Dubaco started to object, to ask Grimaldus to stay, but the Reclusiarch's mind was ironclad. The decision had been made. Grimaldus refused to perform the requested ride upon the Lions. Grimaldus and his charge departed to the Lions' forward base and made for the Eternal Crusader. He went there to put an audacious plan into motion. The chaplain knew he could not return to Hell's Reach, for the Season of Fire played its temptress games around the city, harsh enough to kill sky traffic, but not quite violent enough to interfere with Vox signals. Utilizing the flagship's powerful communication array, he was able to amplify his transmitter signal to send a message through, making contact with the Imperial forces on the ground. He relayed a series of orders to one of the Imperial Guard officers to carry it out. It took several more hours of coordinating Hell's Reach defenses from high orbit. Grimaldus knew a great many Imperial Guard officers were going to Vox skyward for confirmation in hours to come. Time passed as Grimaldus spoke with 81 Imperial Guard officers and 11 Imperial Navy starship captains. As his clearance was Rubicon grade, no one dared to question his orders. Cynaric questioned the senior chaplain's motives, wondering if he hadn't exceeded his authority. He argued that the Lion's survival would be for the best. Yet here, Grimaldus was depleting Hell's Reach defenses to march alongside the Lions into the Mannaheim Gap. The Reclusiarch explained that the Hive City was vastly overdefended now, with entire battalions sitting idle and awaiting redeployment. It was an irritating truth. The soldiers in Hell's Reach were bored. They did not do well with tedium, especially when left alone, with nothing to do and no one to shoot. Cynaric felt that Grimaldus was playing on the people's regard for him. The hero of Hell's Reach called them to war. Of course they would follow, but was this their war? The Reclusiarch argued that it was their world, and it was the only chance the Lions had, if they were to survive. The Lions' unseen enemies might well allow them to die in glory that they deserved, but their deaths served nothing but to ease the soreness of a wounded pride. The Celestial Lions must not die on Armageddon. Without help, the Lions were doomed. Everything centered on just how fast Grimaldus' former forces at Hell's Reach could break out from the storm and redeploy halfway across the world. Arranging for an Imperial Navy shuttle, both Grimaldus and Cynaric deployed to the surface of Armageddon. Dawn was less than an hour away as they broke cloud cover over the Lions' ruined fortress stronghold. Grimaldus wondered if the Lions would have already left their fallen fortress by the time they had arrived, marching toward their last stand. Besides the remaining four dust-blasted and paint-stripped Thunderhawks possessed by the Lions resting upon the wide rooftop platform, dozens of inelegant blocky troop landers joined them. Struggling to locate an unmarked, untaken patch of ground, Grimaldus ordered the shuttle to break off his descent, as both he and Cynaric jumped from the ship's rear bay. The pair of Black Templars descended from the sky to the ground by utilizing their jump pack. Pride Leader Dubaku was taken aback by the arrival of the Black Templars. Grimaldus replied that he thought the Lions might appreciate the extra bodies. The Reclusiarch was greeted by General Kyranov of the Armageddon Steel Legion, the acting commander of the military force at Hell's Reach. Within the hour, a war council was called, ordained before a battalion of revving tanks. The plan was simple. They would march into the Mannaheim Gap, and they would destroy anything that moved or breathed. Dubaku stood with Grimaldus at the heart of the impromptu conclave, his anger a palpable thing. He directed his ire at the Reclusiarch, who he felt overstepped his authority. The Pride leader didn't appreciate these interlopers who threatened to interfere with the Lion's personal vendetta. He argued with Grimaldus that this was the Lion's fight. Dubaku warned Grimaldus that when the time came, when they confronted the Orc warlord responsible for so many of his battle brothers' deaths, it would be a Celestial Lion's blade that killed the creature. Grimaldus vowed that it would be so. And so the Imperial forces gathered from Hell's Reach marched in long armored columns towards the Mannaheim Gap. Every hope they possessed that Mannaheim would be near devoid of enemy titans was crushed before the first Steel Legion soldier set foot on the loose rocky slopes leading down into the canyon. The enemy was present in grotesque force. Great sockets along the canyon walls marked the absence of several gargants, but many more were undergoing repair or reawakening after fighting in recent battles. The ravine was choked by multitudes of orcs going about their work, and thousands of moldering corpses piled up into a sea of decaying organic matter. Gold armor, darkened and soiled by waste, showed among the barricades of the looted dead. The dead lions had been heaped in undignified poses from their Xeno murderers, and their ceramite, useless to the junkyard heresy that constituted greenskin technology, was left to encase the rotting warriors amidst their flesh. The Imperial forces advanced over the sea of the disrespected dead, for tearing the barricades down was not an option. The guardsmen climbed and waded through a sea of bodies or rode their hulls of their tanks. Above the advance rode the gunship fleets, all flanking the four remaining Thunderhawks in the Lion's arsenal. The moment they streaked through the ravine's trench, cannon fire began to bring down in tumbling fireballs. The Steel Legion did not balk at the sight of such a vast enemy horde. They plowed into the enemy's disarrayed ranks, slaughtering them to make room on fields of their bodies for the gunships to land. The first hour of the battle was remarkable only for its ferociousness. The Imperial Guard's mass cannon devastated the greenskin war machines, and in reply, the orcs butchered the guard at every point along the advance, where it fell to men and women with bayonets to hold the line. As was so often the way of the guard, they had the stronger steel, but the enemy had the stronger flesh. In such a grinding lock of armies, winning and losing was relative. The Imperial force pushed deep into the canyon. Hundreds of men and women fell face down into the dirt. Behind, the Space Marines lay a graveyard of tanks, practically all their own, all lost to enemy canyon fire. Lining the canyon walls were the burning metal corpses of towering god constructs, holed by missiles and tank shells, melting to slag in the flames of the Imperial Guard's bombardment. Stubber fire rattled against the Ceramite harmlessly, but Scythe Guardsmen down in droves. Still the Imperials advance, sloshing through a rising torrent of blood. It was knee-deep for most humans, turning all advancements into a sweeping wade through filth. Soon the fulcrum moment of the battle came upon Grimaldis, as it had so many times before him, his heraldry often drawing enemy commanders to him as often as he fought his way to them. It happened again at Mannheim, though he tried to avoid it. The largest of the orcs, doubtless hunting the Reclusiarch by heraldry, launched itself at Grimaldis from behind. It was a thing of blunt fangs, sinewed muscle, and hammering limbs, larger than Grimaldis, and both stronger and faster than him. A lion called out to the Reclusiarch, reminding him that the orc warlord was the prize leader's kill. Grimaldis faced off against this massive beast, swinging his crozius maw at the foul creature, but the powerful greenskin moved as if it was immune to everything thrown against it. Lasfire lanced off the creature, going ignored against its armor, and equally ignored as the volley scored fingertip holes in its flesh. Celestial lions charged the creature, but the hulking warlord countered their feeble assaults with sweeps of his mighty mangling claw. As Grimaldis was driven to his knees and eventually struck to the ground, Dubaku finally came between the two combatants with a leap and a roar. He held his hand back, bidding Grimaldis to remain away. The Reclusiarch had to force himself to obey, something he could never do in any other circumstance. But they had fought this battle for a bloodline's pride, and here was the moment of reckoning. Dubaku beat his blade against his chest plate, staring at the greenskin lord in its power suit of tank-armored scraps. Despite the cacophony of battle that raged around them, Grimaldis could hear the celestial lion's words as clearly as if they had left his own mouth. In whatever underworld your foul breed believes, you shall tell your pig-blooded ancestors that you died to the blade of Echene of Elysium, the lion of the Emperor. No one knew it then, but at that moment, the pride leader was the last lion standing. Dubaku attacked, his chainsword worthless against the beast's cybernetic claw. So what he lacked in strength, he poured into speed. Never blocking, always dodging, the battle did not pause around the two combatants. Soon, both the pride leader and the orc warlord were bleeding from a score of wounds. The chainsword had found its way through the armored joint and plunged into soft tissue. Power Claw had mangled the Celestial Lion's armor each time it fell. Soon, Dubaku was backing away. Fighting such a beast was no task for one warrior alone, no matter the pleasure of pride. Then came a thunderclap of noise as a massive, electric burst turned the air into a charge of static. Orcs and men, in their droves, cried out in pain at the sonic boom. the orbital shield was no longer functional. Somehow, at some point in the hour of melee, while the Reclusiarch fought with the Lions, the Steel Legion had laid explosives at the Void Shield reactor. The Emperor alone knew when, where, and how. No sooner had the shield imploded, spitting its static charge in all direction, than a powerful and priority channel Vox rune chimed loudly into the Reclusiarch's retinal display. Grimaldus activated it as he watched the Pride Leader and the Orc Lord stagger around each other, wounded animals too proud to die. Soon, Grimaldus heard a familiar voice. It was High Marshal Helbrecht. He informed the chaplain that the Black Templars were ready to reinforce their position. All he had to do was give the word. Grimaldus informed the High Marshal to blacken the sky. At that moment, the severely wounded lion was down before Grimaldus could reach him. The beast clutched Dubaku's arm in its mangling claw, crushing it at the bicep before ripping it free. The Pride Leader retaliated by ramming his chainsword in an awkward thrust into the creature's throat. Deflected by the armor, it barely bit. His assault came at the cost of his leg, as the iron claw scissored through the limb of the knee, dropping him on his back into the slime. Grimaldus was on the beast's back in a heartbeat, securing himself by digging into the creature's armor with his boots as he wrapped his severed weapon chain around his bleeding, sweating throat. The iron claw battered at the Reclusiarch, shearing chunks of ceramite away. It staggered without toppling, gasped without truly suffocating. Even this, even strangling it with his last remaining weapon, could not kill it. All Grimaldus could do was buy Dubaku the moment he needed to claw free, which he quickly did, and Cynaric was waiting, a bolter in his remaining hand. The mutilated lion reached up for it, clutching it in one hand in a pistol grip and aiming it up as he lay back in his sludge. Grimaldus dropped back, not completely, but enough to pull the chain tighter, adding his weight to his strength, and wrenching the beast's head back to bare its throat. The bolter sang once, and the kick of something heavy struck near the chain. With a muffled burst, the head came free, tumbling back over its shoulders and landing with the chaplain in the filth. The armored body stood there without anything existing above its neck, still too stubborn, too strong to fall. Once he got on his feet, Grimaldus reclaimed his maul from the fallen beast. Then he tossed the thing's slack-jawed head to Dubaku where he laid. The battle continued to rage as the men and women Grimaldus had led fought their way through the canyon. Dubaku looked up at the darkening sky as the Black Templars descended in a massive drop-pod assault upon the Mannaheim Gap. The lion's only reaction was to rise as best he could and pull his helmet clear. He ordered the Reclusiarch to help him stand. He didn't want to meet the High Marshal on his back. Cynaric and Grimaldus hauled Dubaku up between them. While they did so, the guard Vox Link erupted in cheers as Lord Helmbrick blackened the skies with Black Templar drop pods. After the battle was won, Reclusiarch Grimaldus bid his farewell to the newly installed Chapter Master Ekene Dubaku of the Celestial Lions. He was escorted by his surviving few warriors onto the Black Templar strike cruiser, Blade of the Seventh Sun, with its course plotted to the distant world of Elysium. Dubaku now bore a bionic leg and a noticeable limp, his physiology not entirely adjusted to the augmetic replacements yet. The armor he wore was gold war-plated of an ancient Imperial Fist champion, granted as a gift from the Eternal Crusade's Hall of Memory. His cloak was that of Helbrecht's own sword brethren, red on black, elegantly cast over one shoulder. It is not known if this is the very same cloak that Helbrecht had granted Dubaku when he forced him to take the oath of lordship over his depleted chapter. At his hip, bound by chains of black iron, was the flayed, polished skull of the greenskin they had killed together, an honor indeed to be named the Chapter Master's prime trophy. The Black Templar Honor Guard, comprised to bid him good journey, consisted of the Reclusiarch, the newly promoted Chaplain Cynaric, and the High Marshal's household knights, clad in the ceremonial colors. The Reclusiarch hoped that as time passed, Dubaku's efforts in reconstructing the Celestial Lion's chapter and training a generation to follow him continued to go well. Grimaldus knew they would never meet again, as Dubaku was sworn to a life of defending what he could hold, and the Black Templars always sailed forth to attack. As for the hero of Hell's Reach, he continues to find in the Emperor's name. No battle is so bleak that Grimaldus's appearance cannot turn the tide and rekindle the fire in his brothers' hearts. And those were 40 facts on High Chaplain Merrick Grimaldus. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, thank our patrons on Patreon. It's because of them that we can do these types of videos. Link in the description if you guys want to become a supporter. It's $1 a month. The dollar goes towards us creating videos and the giveaways. Now, speaking about giveaways, today we're going to be doing our subscriber appreciation giveaway. And we are giving away a Terminator Chaplain. Because of Chaplain Grimaldus. Now, of course, Chaplain Grimaldus is not a Terminator Chaplain, but the Terminator Chaplain is actually much better on the tabletop than just your regular everyday Chaplain. Maybe even better than Grimaldus. I'm not too sure. I have to check the stats on Grimaldus. The way for you to win this is simple. All you have to do is like this video, so hit the thumbs up button. Be a subscriber, because this is a subscriber appreciation giveaway, so hit the little bell notification icon right next to subscribe. Share this with your friends. You can share it on Twitter, Reddit, Facebook, whatever social media you guys use, and most importantly, comment down in the comment section below. You can comment as many times as you want. Just be careful. If you spam, YouTube will knock you out, and your comments will count for nothing. So just comment in the comment section below. You can come back every day, comment like 3 or 4 times a day. I've seen that work for some people, but either way. Yeah, can't wait to talk to you guys in the comment section, and the winner will be announced a week from now. So I think next Saturday or Sunday, depending on when this goes out. Thanks for everything, and I'll talk to you tomorrow. This was Gersh1 with One Mind Syndicate signing out. I'm not afraid.